remarks as welcome address, and then you will start your lecture. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Professor Dr. Walchod.
Yeah, sure. Thank you very much. Good morning and good afternoon. As always, we are in time. Okay, so let me begin by thanking our very distinguished speaker, Professor Dr. Stephen Huiz, who is a professor and chair of Department of Mathematics in K. Leuven University, Belgium, for sparing time for this presentation. You see, the key objective of this whole program is that we do have lots of activities from the platform of COMSTEC, which is a 57 countries consortium under the Organization of Islamic Countries. But very often we miss out the basic sciences, the one which are actually extremely important, because the foundation of science is based on conceptual framework. And unless and until we strengthen that framework, we cannot really expect young researchers to do high quality science. And this is the reason that I requested my very dear friend and very well-respected physicist, Professor Dr. Hamid Salim, to lead this initiative and to help us in identifying very distinguished scholars who are willing to spend some time on developing this particular aspect of education. So this entire series is very similar to UNESCO basic science program, with the difference is that we have decided to confine ourselves to only four subjects, which is mathematics, physics, chemistry, and biology, and to very carefully select areas in which there is a genuine need of conceptual development. We intend to do that more often, and we intend to do it in a different way. For instance, the Distinguished Scholars Program, in which Dr. Stephen is now giving presentation, but we intend to have animation, we intend to have a number of other ways through which we can send this message across. And the objective is to somehow develop understanding and appreciation of the basic concept of sciences, which are absolutely essential. Today's presentation is certainly an extremely important aspect. It is a welcome addition to COMSTEC Distinguished Scholars Program. And we are so fortunate to have someone of the stature of Professor Stephen with us, for which I'm so extremely grateful. I would request Professor Dr. Hamid Salim for the introduction of our guests.
So, Professor Dr. Stephen Huiz is professor and also chairman, Department of Mathematics at Katholieke University, Leuven, University, Belgium. And he has been working on solar dynamics for the last many years and contributed very important research papers in this field. He has thousands of citations and hundreds of research papers, and many students from Pakistan, this is important to mention, have done collaborative research under his supervision, and also some have done PhD in his university, K. Leuven University, Belgium, under his supervision. And he has, even I have been collaborating with him during last many years. So we are very grateful to his contributions in developing plasma physics and astrophysics in Pakistan as well. And I hope his lecture will be interesting for all the countries of COMSTEC and the people who are listening and attending this lecture. It will be useful them, for them. And I think in COMSTEC, the countries, OIC countries, should also start astrophysical and astronomical research. So I welcome Professor Stephen Huiz and invite him to kindly start his lecture.
Okay, thank you. So let me try to thank you for this nice introduction, Hamid and Professor Shadari. it's an honor for me actually to be able to speak for such a nice audience. Because of the diversity of the people attending this webinar, I made it not too mathematical. Actually, I try to avoid too much mathematics, so it will be accessible. Everybody should be able to understand it. I should try to share my screen. Wait, how to do that? Share screen. Screen to one. Now I have to. One second. Open the talk. Yeah. I hope you can see my screen now. Is it correct?
Yeah, this is very clear.
Yeah. So it is nice for me to be able to talk to give this lecture. Indeed, I had several collaborators from Pakistan and countries around. I had two PhD students from Pakistan, actually, and many collaborators that come here for several months, actually, usually with this HEC grants. One just left, actually, last week, who was here also for 6 months. So today I will talk about my project, which is called Euphoria 2.0. But first, let me introduce where I am. I am in Belgium, in Leuven, which is a city very close to Brussels, as you can see on this map. It's just 25 kilometers from Brussels. By train, it's 20 minutes. And of course, we are in the center of Europe, so we're also very close to Paris, to London, to Amsterdam, and Cologne. So it's a very nice area to be. The university itself is actually a very big university. It's the largest university in Belgium. We have more than 12,000 people staff, and more than 9,000 people working in university hospitals. There are more than 7,500 researchers and more than 60,000 students, of which 12,000 are international students. So we are actually have 157 different nationalities of students in our university. Very big university. Also, our rector is very proud that we are number one on this world ranking of most innovative universities in Europe. We are seventh on the world ranking, but we are the first in Europe. And also we score rather high on this QS World University ranking and on this Times Higher Education World University ranking. So, but today I want to talk about Euphoria. And so first I will give the motivation of the talk, and it is actually space weather. So I will define space weather. I will show the consequences of space weather and the socioeconomic impact, which is a very big driver for this kind of research. And then I will introduce you to two models that we developed here in Leuven. One is called Euphoria. It's an acronym. I will explain it. But it's a model for the heliospheric wind and CME propagation and evolution to predict actually a time of arrival and the impact that CMEs will have at Earth. And then we also developed a model which is called PARADISE, which is also an acronym, which I also will explain later. And that is a model for particle transport and acceleration in the solar wind. The particles, these accelerated particles, also cause some damage, and we want to mitigate that damage. And then after I have introduced these two models, I can talk about the project Euphoria 2.0, which is actually going to develop better versions of these models and combine them. So we call this a project sometimes Euphoria in Paradise, because we want to combine them and make it available to the general public, to everybody via the Virtual Space Weather Modeling Center, which I also will talk about later in this talk. So I will show you some results we obtained so far. The project is ongoing. We actually are finalizing the second year of the project, a three-year project. The second year is finished by the end of this month. And then I will tell you what we plan to do in the next year, the last year. So you're probably familiar with the solar wind, which is a stream of particles that leaves the sun. There's a lot of particles because the sun is a rather big volume, of course. It's leaving the sun at 10 to 9 kilograms per second. And there are many observations of the solar wind, many in situ measurements by satellites also. And here you see actually a relatively new processed solar wind images from STEREO-A, which is a satellite corona graph on this satellite is CORE2, and there was a very high resolution images by following the plasma. Actually, they could improve the resolution much better. This is a paper from De Forest et al. So the solar wind fills the entire solar system, which is called the heliosphere, the part of space where the wind has the sun has some influence, but the particles are relatively low density, so say between half and 10 kilo electron volt. The wind, I should say, is not uniform. There's actually two, it's a bimodal wind, as they say. So there's a slow and a fast wind. And slow and fast are relative, because slow means at this point 300 kilometers per second, so more than a million kilometers per hour. But it is relatively slow because there's also a fast wind, which is like 750 or more kilometers per second. It is not only the speed of the wind that is distinguishing these two winds. It's also their density. For instance, the slow wind is much more dense than the fast wind, but also the chemical composition is different from the two, which means that they originate from different regions on the sun. But the solar wind drags out, of course, the solar magnetic field, which is then called the interplanetary magnetic field. This is some showing how it works. The sun is rotating, so we get this spiral structure of the magnetic field lines in the solar system, the interplanetary magnetic field as this spiral structure. On top of this wind, you also have coronal mass ejections. So you have solar storms, which you can see here in these movies on the left upper part of the screen. These are enormous clouds of hot plasma that are launched into space at propagation speeds of typically 450 kilometers per second, but they can be much, much faster, up to 3,000 kilometers per second. Yeah, and of course, when you have a halo CME, like if you see it all around the sun, it is coming in our direction, and they are so fast that they can have a lot of impact, a lot of influence at Earth, even though the sun is on average 150 million kilometers away from us. It's not only, so here is actually this loop that is becoming unstable, and this is the Earth to scale, so it's a huge structure, yeah? So even very far away, it can influence the Earth. And then apart from that, you also have solar flares, which are intense releases of high energy radiation, so EUV, X-rays, gamma rays, and these accelerate particles. There's a magnetic connection going on, which impulsively accelerates particles. And these accelerated particles also emit radio waves. You can trace them, but they also kind of affect the Earth. And these actually arrive at Earth already half an hour after they are accelerated. There's a relation between the two. Most of the big solar flares are correlated with coronal mass ejection, but not always. You have flares that are not correlated to coronal mass ejection and vice versa. But many, much of the time, they are actually observed together. I mentioned the solar energetic particles. And here you see a kind of sketch. You see the sun, you see this coronal mass ejection, which is this typical flux rope structure. And particles are, of course, charged particles. These are electrons and protons and different kinds of heavier ions. And of course, they feed the magnetic field, so they kind of gyrate around magnetic field lines. But coronal mass ejections, they can also accelerate particles, because they are so fast, they create a shockwave. And in the shockwave, particles are also accelerated. And not only just in the beginning, but all the way as the CME propagates through the heliosphere. So these are called the gradial solar energetic particle events, which are even more dangerous than the impulsive ones. So I mentioned that electrons, protons, and ions that are involved, and the energies involved are much, much larger than the particles in the background solar wind. These are particles with kilo electron volt and even giga electron volt. Yeah, so one mega electron volt proton travels at 14,000 kilometers per second. A giga electron volt proton travels almost at the speed of light. Yeah, so this is much more energetic than the background wind. They are charged, so that means that they feed the magnetic field, and so they spiral around the interplanetary magnetic field. Now, what is space weather? So there are many different definitions of space weather, but the definition I prefer is the one that is used in the USA National Space Weather Plan, the strategic plan. And there they say that space weather, the term space weather, refers to the conditions on the sun and in the solar wind, but also in the magnetosphere of the Earth and in the ionosphere and the thermosphere, that can influence the performance and the reliability of space-borne and ground-based technological systems and can endanger human life or health. Yeah, because of course the radiation, especially when you're not protected, when you go out in space, like in the International Space Station, you're less protected by the atmosphere and by the magnetosphere, and then you can get some radiation. I will come to that later. But both our instruments in space, of course, they are very vulnerable, all the satellites, but also ground-based equipment is affected by space weather. This was not realized until a couple of decades ago. And the reason for that is these magnetic structures on the sun. So here you see another of these loops. Here you see the size of the Earth compared to the same scale. And so you have this huge structure that can be actually stable for many weeks or months, even several solar rotations. Like this one was, I think, 3-4 solar rotations steady, and then all of a sudden became unsteady and kind of exploded and was ejected into the space. And the reason for that is somehow, a philosophical reason, is the fact that dV equals zero. You know that gravity wants to make the stars and also the sun, of course, spherically symmetric, but dV equals zero cannot be realized in a spherically symmetric way. You can try it, but it is not possible. So the magnetic field kind of prevents that, and there's a constant battle between the Lorentz force and the gravity. And in the atmosphere of the sun, the Lorentz force is actually much stronger than gravity. And gravity is, of course, in the sun much larger than gravity at Earth. It's like 27 times larger than at Earth. Only 27 times, because the radius of the sun is also much larger than the radius of the Earth, of course. But still, the Lorentz force is much, much stronger than the gravity. Actually, in a lot of models for coronal loops, gravity is just ignored. Now, the solar flares and CMEs, when the CME is ejected, of course, in the direction of Earth, you can see it as a halo CME. Here you see a movie of the during solar maximum. This was the August 1999. Speeded up, as you can see, these are the days counting. And you see there are many of these CMEs occurring, and it is estimated about 10% of all the CMEs has influences and impact at the Earth, so in some way. And so this is more than one per week during solar maximum. During solar minimum, it is less, but still several, one or two per month during solar minimum. Now, the typical velocities I mentioned are 450 kilometers per second, but they can be very fast, up to 3,000 kilometers per second. So they normally a CME travels like 2 to 3 days from the sun to the Earth. But of course, if they have velocities of 3,000 kilometers per second, they can be here in less than 1 day, actually. It's a huge amount of mass that is that they have. So it's 10 to the 13 to 10 to the 16th grams. Yeah, 10 to the 16th grams, that's a lot. I was told it is comparable to the mass of the Himalaya. Now, of course, if you launch this kind of mass with these velocities into space, there's a lot of energy involved. And the biggest CMEs have like 10 to the 33 ERGs, 10 to the 26 joules of energy, which is also really a lot. It's thousands of atom bombs at the same time. And these are the most violent phenomena that occur in the entire solar system. Nevertheless, they have been observed. There are pictures drawings of Chinese observations of thousands of years ago. But the name coronal mass ejection is due to Grüttner. It was first used in a paper in 72 after analyzing data from this OZO 7 mission in 71. Grüttner first used the term coronal mass ejection. It has many effects, these coronal mass ejections, and one of them is, of course, radiation. So first of all, spacecraft are not protected by the less protected by the atmosphere, and also less protected by the magnetosphere. And so there are many instruments that are damaged or even killed by these effects. And during the last 25 years, there are 4,500 spacecraft anomalies reported. Now, that might seem a lot, but of course, you have to realize that there's more than 1,000 satellites circulating the Earth at this moment in time. And so one effect is also radiation, as you could see here in this person doing an EVA, so an extra vehicle activity. If an astronaut is doing an extra vehicle activity during the passage of such a CME, with these accelerated particles, he would get a radiation dose of 50 millisieverts, so 5 rems. Which is a lot. So the maximum that they can get is 250 millisievert. So it's 1/5 of their total dose. If they would get do this 2 or 3 times, they would have to abort the mission, which is also very expensive, of course. So they try to avoid it. So they look at the space weather forecast before they leave the International Space Station. But there are many other effects, like, for instance, if you see that because the wind is not uniform, you can see here in this simulation that the magnetic field of the magnetosphere is changed in time. And we know from Maxwell's equations that when you change magnetic field in time, you induce an electric field in everything that is long and conducting. So power grid, oil pipelines, even long bridges can get these currents, geomagnetically induced currents, they call it. On the left, you see an impression, artist impression of how this SEPs would work. And you see the particles impacting the magnetosphere of the Earth, which is our magnetic shield, actually, against the space weather. But then you can get, of course, via the Van Allen belts, they can get to the close to the surface of the Earth and, in fact, create the only positive effect of space weather, which is this aurora, which we also can predict because we understand phase weather much better. So you see that there's a need for reliable predictions of the space weather. And reliable predictions are necessary to because of the effect on our technological systems and because of the effect of human life and health. And of course, if you want to do a reliable prediction, you need to have a deeper insight in the physics behind the space weather. Because a lot of the initial models were actually empirical models, trying to describe in a formula what is seen and trying to use it as a prediction. But of course, if you don't know the real cause of the phenomenon, it is very difficult to do a reliable prediction. So in the beginning, when they tried to predict space weather, there were a lot of false alarms or missed alarms, actually. So sometimes they thought, okay, there's a big CME, we should warn everybody, and then it turned out to have no effect at Earth. And that was because we didn't understand the role of the magnetic field of the CME in this impact. I will come to that later. Observations are, of course, very needed to do reliable predictions, but sometimes they are limited, of course, and they are difficult to interpret because of projection effects, for instance. If you want to estimate the velocity of the CME, but you're looking at an angle, it is there's a huge projection effect. And some things you can simply not observe directly, like the magnetic field of the solar corona. There is no way to measure it. The magnetic field in the photosphere, you can measure from Zeeman splitting of the spectral lines, but in the photos in the corona, it is much weaker signal and you cannot do that. So additional information can be obtained from numerical simulation models. And these can provide us additional information that cannot be observed directly, like the magnetic field topology in the corona. We can solve the equations and use the observed surface magnetogram as a boundary condition and then get an idea of how the magnetic field structure looks like in the solar corona. But also, like the density, we have no way of measuring the density. You can kind of derive from MHD models of the solar corona, also local velocities, etc. So we get additional information on top of the observations, and the observations are, of course, limited. And for predicting the Earth weather, which is also sometimes challenging, there you should realize that there is a weather station every so many kilometers. So they have the temperature, they have the pressure, they have all this information in such a huge dense grid, while in space there's just a few satellites that are measuring in situ, and they're all in front of the Earth. And now, of course, they have a Parker Solar Probe and Solar Orbiter, which are much going closer to the Sun. But that's it, just two or three measuring points, and that's what you have to do with. So you don't have all the information that they have to predict space weather. Moreover, space weather is very complex and it is multidisciplinary. Yeah, so I already mentioned the coronal mass ejections and the flares and the impulsive SEP events that flares cause. So the coronal mass ejection is not only ejecting a lot of mass into the heliosphere, but also magnetic field. And the CME could also stand for coronal magnetic field ejection, because the magnetic field turns out to be crucial to define the impact of the CME at Earth. So you have also often several subsequent CMEs occurring from the same active region on the Sun. And usually when the second one comes on the same place, it actually catches up with the first one, because the first one has kind of cleaned the path. So the density of the wind then becomes lower, which means the Alfvén velocity is higher and the second CME travels faster and they catch up. You have CME interactions often already before they reach the Earth. So you get very complex magnetic events. You also have these shocks, of course, which causes gradual SEP events. And then, of course, when they hit the magnetosphere, they have many effects of these currents, these geometrically induced currents, as I mentioned, and therefore a lot of effects at Earth, which you can kind of summarize here. I mentioned the power grid or oil pipelines. Of course, satellites are also affected, which means that anything that has to do with satellites is affected, and it's not only telecommunication, but also navigation. Yeah? All ships navigate on GPS, airplanes navigate on GPS, they land on GPS even, so it becomes a bit dangerous if you kind of fully rely on that, because during a geomagnetic storm, this is not so reliable, these signals. But there are many different applications, too many to mention actually, even drilling for oil, because these drills are, it's very complicated in an oil field, there are many already pipelines there, and then they have to drill another hole. They have to try to avoid the other pipelines that are already there, so they need an accuracy of 1 meter. But they guide this drill, because they don't, if there's a big rock, they drill around it. So they have to guide this drill with GPS. And so also there, they have to take into account these geomagnetic storms. If there's a magnetic storm going on, they are not drilling, because it's not safe. They could hit other pipes that are already there. And so there's also, of course, the insurance companies are also interested, because they want to know if there's damage on satellites, if it could have been avoided, yes or no. So there's many, many different applications. In fact, there's also a lot of damage. Yeah? The estimated average economic costs is 10 to the 10 euro per year. This is for the normal space weather. However, there are sometimes these extreme events, like in 1859, there was a Carrington event. That was a huge solar flare and a huge CME that reached the Earth after 18 or 19 hours already. So it must have gone faster than 3,000 kilometers per second. And that in those days, there was no technology. There were no satellites, of course, but there was like telex. And there were these currents were observed in these telex cables. And some of the telex stations actually burned down because of these currents. Now, if it would such an event, like this Carrington event, would occur now, it is estimated by Eastwood and colleagues in 2017 that it would cost $2.7 trillion or euros costs. This is an order of magnitude larger than these hurricanes. Katarina, for instance, in New Orleans, it was an order of magnitude lower than this. Moreover, the recovery time to repair all the damage would be 6 to 10 years, according to this paper. So, of course, these extreme events do not occur too often. Only it is estimated that they would occur only every 100 or 200 years. But the last one was in 1859. Yeah, and so there's also now estimates of how likely such an event would occur in the next 10 years. And I think the current, the latest paper I've seen on that was like, I think 12% chance that that would happen. So of course, if we can predict it, we can try to mitigate some of the damage, not all of it, but some of the damage, because the modern satellites, the vulnerable parts of the instruments, like the CCD cameras, they can be protected. They can put a shield in front of it so that if these high energy particles do not hit it and do not damage it. Moreover, there's of course a link between space weather and climate change, and this has not been investigated yet. I think this in the next decade, there will be studies linking the space weather models to the global circulation models for Earth weather, because now these global circulation models, they just assume that the input from the sun is constant. Yeah, and so it is not constant, of course, and it is likely that these effects have influence on cloud formation and things like that, and therefore also on the Earth weather and the Earth climate. So this is the kind of extensive motivation for the work. Now, let me talk a bit about the model. EFORIA is an acronym, and it means European Heliospheric Forecasting Information Asset. It consists of two parts. There's a corona model and a heliospheric model. The original corona model was a very simple, semi-empirical Wang Shi Li Arch model. It starts from a magnetogram, so a measurement of the magnetic field strength at the surface of the sun. Then we do a potential field source surface extrapolation. So we assume that the magnetic field in the corona is potential. So you can write as a gradient of phi, then the divergence of B equals zero. So the Laplacian of phi has to be zero. This is your equation. The boundary condition is this measured radial component of the magnetic field. And the source surface, you put a 2.5 solar radial typically, and you assume that the magnetic field is purely radial at that point. And then you get what is called the potential field source surface extrapolation. And then you have this Schatten current sheet model that kind of gives you the velocity also at 0.1 AU. And so the model that we use now is very simple, but the only purpose is to give us boundary conditions at 0.1 AU, because that is where the heliospheric part of the model starts. And the heliospheric part of the model contains a lot of physics. Actually, it's a 3D time-dependent ideal MHD model. And so there we can just compute the solar wind. Here you see the radial velocity, you see the density. It's a 3D model, but we make here cuts in the equatorial plane. And this is in the meridional plane of the Earth. The blue dot here is the Earth, and here also. The other dots are other planets and satellites. And this is Mars, this is Stereo A, this is Venus and Mercury. So you can compute the background wind. The sun is rotating, so this is in HEEQ coordinates, so that the position of the Earth, the longitude of the Earth is always the same. And so then you get the CMEs you can superpose on top of that, and then you can actually predict when the CME will hit the Earth and how big the shock will be and things like that. That's the idea of the model. But the rationale is actually that there's a scientific part of the model, of the project, that we want to quantify the deformation and the deflection and the erosion of the flux slopes as they evolve through the heliosphere. There's mass erosion, also magnetic flux erosion. We want to characterize the magnetosheets of the CMEs, and we want to clarify the role of CME-CME interactions in enhanced SEP production. But there's also a very practical part of the model, that is, of course, the space weather forecast. There is an American model also called ENLIL that exists already for like 10 or 15 years. And EFORIA has been called the European ENLIL. Although I think we try to do better than ENLIL, of course. ENLIL predicts the time of arrival, but we also want to predict the geo-effectiveness of the CMEs. And to do that, you need an advanced CME model. ENLIL and EFORIA originally had very simple CME models that could create the shockwave and then predict when the shock would arrive and how strong the shock would be upon arrival. But you need more to predict the impact the CME will have at Earth. We also want to support space missions like Parker Solar Probe and Solar Orbiter. because we can also, of course, predict what the wind characteristics will be at any time during the orbit of these satellites. Yeah, we have the description of the orbit. We can read out the data any point in this 3D heliosphere. Now, the coronal model, as I mentioned, is semi-empirical. So we start from this magnetogram. We have this PFZ model. We have this Schatten current sheet model. And then we can get the radial magnetic field component at 0.1 AU. Yeah. And then from that, we have also this Wang Shi Li arch formula to predict the velocity depending on this factor F, which is kind of the fanning out factor of the field lines. And so there is an empirical formula here that predicts how the velocity will be. So we get also a radial velocity at 0.1 AU. And then the density and the temperature are just from conservation laws estimated. And so we have density, we have temperature, we have the velocity and the radial magnetic field. And with this, we can solve the MHD equations. But we, of course, there's more. FORIA is actually a data-driven model. So I also mentioned the magnetogram. And by the way, we can use different magnetograms. We usually use Gong magnetograms or Gong adapt magnetograms, but you also can use the HMI magnetograms from Solar Dynamic Observatory or MDI or MWO Wilcox magnetograms. We can use different ones. And we can, for the CMEs, so the CME parameters, we use the coronagraph imagery like GCS and Stereocat models that are, I will come to that a bit later. So the magnetograms gives the coronal model. The coronagraph imagery gives the input parameters of the CME. And we have, in the meantime, several CME models, as I will tell you later. So we started with the cone model, like in Enlil, but then we put the magnetic field in this cone model, which gave us a Sferamak model. And then we also have a torus model. We have Fry 3D, which is also this flux rope model. And we are experimenting with that and seeing, trying to find out which one can give us the better prediction at Earth or at other planets or satellites. So these are fed into this heliospheric model where we do this evolution in on a physics-based model, namely MHD. Let me just show you what the problem is with the cone CME model. Here you see one of the first simulations we did. Here you see the radial velocity again, and here you see the density in the equatorial plane and in the meridional plane of the Earth. And on the bottom, actually in red, you see what is measured by the ACE satellite, which is just in front of the Earth, between the Sun, on the Sun-Earth line in Lagrange point L1. And in blue, you see the synthetic data obtained from the numerical simulation. And you see here that, of course, when this shock arrives, like now, you see that this one arrives and there's another shock now. The shocks are seen in this data here. And of course, you see that in blue, the first shock was a bit late, a few hours late in the prediction, and the second shock as well. So there's of course room for improvement, but the main problem is the fact that we cannot predict the magnetic field with the cone CME, because the cone CME is just a blob of plasma with a higher pressure and a higher density, and this it can only create a shock wave but not the internal magnetic field of the cone of the CME. And therefore, here for instance, you see the signal of the Z component of magnetic field, which turns out to be very important to quantify the impact of the CME at Earth. We cannot predict it at all with the cone CME because there is no internal magnetic field. It is important, this component, because the Earth is also a dipole, well, more or less dipole field. And of course, the polarity of the CME, of the magnetic field of the CME is the same as the polarity of the magnetosphere, they kind of repel each other and there will be less interaction. But of course, if the polarity is different, so if the BZ component is negative upon interaction with the magnetosphere, they will actually attract each other and there will be a lot of magnetic reconnection and a lot of these particles will enter the magnetosphere. That's why this BZ component is actually crucial and you should be able to predict it. So we need more advanced CME models. We did tests actually with like the Gibson and Lowe a flux rope model, and here you see the same simulation left with the cone CME and right with the Gibson and Lowe flux rope CME. And what I show now is the BZ component in the equatorial plane and in the meridional plane of the Earth. Negative is red, blue is positive, and you see that there's a of course, much better, much more effect with a flux rope than with a cone. Of course, the cone will also disturb the background wind, which is also magnetized, and therefore you see these ripples also here, but they are much smaller than when you actually launch a flux rope. And when you try to compare the prediction of the magnetic field component, and in particular the Z component of the magnetic field, you see, of course, you do not have all these details because of the limited spatial resolution, but you have the major feature that the curve becomes positive and then becomes negative as the flux rope passes by the position of the Earth. And so this also the order of magnitude is correct. So this is working. You can actually do that. Of course, the resolution of the simulation is much lower. It's low because we want to do the simulation fast. We need to do a prediction. Yeah? So you are also limited in that respect. We try to do the simulation in less than 2 hours so that you can do several simulations because there's some uncertainty on the input parameters and we want to do more than one simulation to be sure. Now, as I said, we improved the cone semi by including magnetic field, and we first put a linear force-free spheromak model into this cone CME, and that was expected to improve the BZ predictions at 1 AU, and therefore also the geo-effectiveness, the quantitative impact of the CME at Earth. And of course, it's a spherical model still. So the real CME is this flux rope structure. So what we found out is that this spheromak is very good for the top of the CME. So if it's a full hit at Earth, so if Earth is here when the CME hits, with the spheromak, you can actually do a very good prediction and a very good fitting of the data that are observed at L1, just before the Earth. But when it is a side hit, so when the Earth would be here and would be hit by a leg of the CME, then the spheromak model is not very good because the spheromak doesn't have legs, of course. Now we need 10 input parameters. Well, for the cone CME, we only need 7 input parameters that we also need for the flux rope CMEs. There's a speed, the time, the longitude, latitude, the width of the CME, the density, and the temperature. And for the spheromak, we also need the flux rope tilt, the orientation, the helicity, and the flux, the toroidal flux in the spheromak. So I said it is a data-driven model. So indeed, for instance, we use this Stereocat data, the databases of the observation of the CMEs. And here you see, for instance, two pictures of coronagraphs with, 48 minutes difference. And so you can kind of estimate the width of the CME by looking at this thing. And then you see, okay, the CME is at this point here, at this time. At this time, it is evolved up to here. So then you can, from the difference in these two, you can estimate the speed of the CME. Yeah. So you have a kind of idea of the spread angle of the CME. You have an idea of the speed of the CME. You have an idea of the location where it occurred. So longitude, latitude, and so this way you can kind of determine these parameters from observations. Of course, so these are from reconstruction with a model that is called the graduated cylindrical shell model, a GCS model that is often used to determine these 5 parameters of the CME. Of course, for the CME density and temperature, there is no model and we have no idea, so we always use a default value. Of course, if we do a historic event study, we have this is a parameter in our code, so we can play with it to get a better fit of the data. But for a prediction, we have no clue, so we just put an average value of density and temperature. Whereas for the magnetic field, we use magnetic field and EUV observations of the source region. There's a paper of Erika Palmerio, 2017, that explains how you can do that. And for the total flux, there's a model from Nath Gopalswamy that also kind of estimates the total flux in an active region where the CME came from. Of course, there are huge boundary errors, errors on these estimates. For instance, the model of Gopalswamy tries to estimate the total flux in the active region, but not all the flux is released upon the CME. So you don't know what fraction of it is released. So there's like a factor of 2 difference probably in what is actually released and what is estimated. So you have to take that into account when you try to interpret the predictions. But sometimes we get very nice results, like in September 2017, there were two CMEs, and we kind of tried to model them with Euphoria. There were two small CMEs, actually, but they created a very big geomagnetic storms, and we didn't know how that was possible, that such small CMEs would create such a big storm at Earth. And so we did some simulation with our Spheromax, and it turned out that the two flux orbs are actually interacting with each other just before they reach the Earth. And so here you can see the BZ component in the simulation. In the black dots are the observations, and in the simulation we get a very similar time profile. In the simulation is a bit occurring too early, but it's a bit, well, it should be a little bit more negative in the simulation compared to the observations, but it's like of the same order of magnitude and just a bit, a couple of hours too early. And the way we obtained it was by launching two Spheromax CMEs on 4th and 6th of September. They were also observed to be there on these two dates, and they were both oriented in the same direction. With this, we tried different orientations, but with the same direction, we get the best fit of the data. And so when they arrive at the virtual spacecraft around the Earth, they have an enhanced shock. You see here the total magnetic field, which is very similar to what is observed, but a bit too early in the simulation. But the most important one is the BZ component, because this is the one that actually defines the impact of the CME at Earth. Of course, we have in a simulation all the information. We know the density, magnetic field, the velocity at any point in time and at any point in the heliosphere. So we can make nice visualizations. And doing this, we discovered what is going on. Here you see the first flux rope, and this is the second flux rope. And what is going on is the plasma. So as they interacted, the plasma in between them was squeezed, and this caused the negative BZ component. This was figured out by doing this kind of visualization and kind of doing these simulations. So this was a nice result we are very proud of. The second quote I want to talk to about is PARADISE, which is also an acronym, and it stands for Particle Radiation Asset Directed at Interplanetary Space Exploration. So it's a new model of energetic particles propagating through the lower energy solar wind. And just to give you an idea on how it works, we have these anisotropy profiles, or you can also do intensity profiles. I will show them later. So this is the definition of the anisotropy. Yeah? So if there is not, normally if there's not much scattering, then there's a big anisotropy, the magnetic field. The particles follow the magnetic field lines, are guided by the magnetic field in that case. And so we can study these time profiles of this anisotropy. Here you see the simulation of the cone CME, then you see the particles, and you see when they reach the observer, which is at this point, as soon as they arrive there, then you see the anisotropy going up first and then going down, which means that particles come from the other direction. This model is based on the focus transport equation. So we start from the Vlasov equation in mixed coordinates. Here X is expressed in the inertial frame, and the momentum density, and this nu is the cosine actually of the pitch angle, is expressed in terms in the frame co-moving with the solar wind. And we assume that the turbulent fluctuations are on average affected with the solar wind, and there are some additional assumptions. So we have the gyro angle phi here is in a uniform field, omega times t, with omega the gyro frequency and t the time. And we assume that we have a gyrotropic distribution function. We assume that there is no dependence of this distribution function to phi, so this term drops out. But the focus transport equation takes a lot of things into account. So we decompose solar wind variables in an ensemble average part and a stochastic part. And then we group all these stochastic terms together and we average them over the gyro phase. And then you can write this as in a set of five stochastic differential equations. So these are, this one is three components, and then one for the evolution of the cosine of the pitch angle and one for the momentum and momentum magnitude. And then you can, all these terms here, which we take into account the convection the streaming, the GC drifts. We take into account focusing and mirroring because of the magnetic field, momentum changes, and also the diffusion due to turbulence. Yeah, we assume that we take the assumption of quasi-linear theory in the first instance, and the diffusion approach is also valid on a more general non-linear assumptions. Of course, there can be different diffusion models that give different diffusion coefficients, and we're actually trying out different models now to see which ones give the better results. But it gives nice results. For instance, here I'm going to show you one case where we have this code CME, of which I already showed the anisotropy time profile. You can also show the intensity profiles. Here we just took a uniform background twin and the cone CME, which is injected at 2,000 kilometers per second. Yeah, and then we can put the source of the particles in the shock of the CME, and then we can simulate a gradial SEP event. And here we have three observers, the orange, the green, and the purple one here. And you will see that they see the effect of the accelerated particles at different times. When I run this video, you see in the beginning, of course, they do not measure anything. But then here, this observer first sees the intensity going up. Then the second observer also sees the intensity going up. And then last but not least, the third, the orange observer also gets particles now that are accelerated, and the intensities go up. You can do these intensity profiles for different energy levels, and you can compare them with actually measurements, because if these observers are satellites, you can measure these things and then compare with the measurements. A second example is here, correlating interaction region. So if you have a high stream, fast speed stream into a uniform background wind, because of the rotation of the sun, you get this spiraling structure, but you also create a forward shock and a reverse shock. Here, this is the reverse shock, and this is the forward shock. This is the radial speed. If you show the azimuthal speed, you can see that a co-rotating interaction region, CIR it is called, is formed, and is bounded by this forward shock and by this reverse shock, and the shock plasmas. The shock plasmas are separated by a stream interface, which you can see in this azimuthal component of the velocity. Now, if we put a source of particles in this high-speed stream, low energy particles, 4 mega electron volt, all ions, all about the same initial energy, then you can see what happens. This CIR can actually increase the energy of these particles. And then it turns out, if you take into account cross-field diffusion, yes or no, these terms that I was showing in the equation before. On the left, you see the simulation without cross-field diffusion. On the right, you see the simulation with cross-field diffusion. And first of all, what we see is that there are many differences from a background Parker spiral magnetic field. Most of the SEP models do not take into account the simulated magnetic field. What most of the models do is they just assume an analytic solution for the background field, which consists of the Parker spiral. And then they compute how the particles will propagate along this Parker spiral. But what we do is we simulate first the background field with Fourier, and then we get these shocks, which you don't have in the Parker spiral, and then you get this acceleration in this CIR shocks, which you can, of course, not do with a traditional SEP model. We see long-lasting high intensities at small radial distances. We have a magnetic bottle that is formed, which, of course, is not modeled by a Parker spiral. And we get also cross-field diffusion, very small cross-field diffusion has a very large effect. And the CIR particles can move between magnetic field lines with large footpoint separation. Here I want to show another case where you can get accelerated particle population without cross-field diffusion. You get this population here, but with cross-field diffusion, there seems to be a second particle population developing, and this has actually been observed. Yeah, so this we are very proud that our code can simulate such complicated effects. Here you see a snapshot where the second population is centered around the forward shock. and as I said, is observed and is due to the cross-free diffusion, because without cross-free diffusion, we do not have this development of this secondary particle population. Now, I've introduced the two models to you. What is now the purpose of the project EFORIA 2.0 or EFORIA in Paradise, the European Horizon 2020 project and the ESA heliospheric modeling techniques project? Well, the objective is to, in fact, combine these two models and to address the geo-effectiveness and the impacts and mitigation, including extreme events also related to solar eruptions and solar wind streams and solar energetic particles. And we want to do is also couple the code to models for geomagnetically induced currents and for radiation. And we actually want to predict radiation in a particular satellite or geomagnetically induced currents in the entire European power grid. We already have maps of the grid. We have maps of the conductivity of the surface of the Earth. And so when we couple these models to EFORIA, we will actually be able not only predict when the CME will arrive, but even which currents will be observed in the power grid. Of course, the longest distances will get the highest currents. So this is the idea, and then we want to make this model available. So what we want to do for that, so specific objectives are to develop advanced flux models, improve the MHD corona, because when we want to do the gradual SEP events, we should start much closer to the sun than 0.1 AU. 0.1 AU is 21.5 solar radii. The shock is created much closer to the sun. So now we can only pick it up at 0.1 AU, but we want to start a simulation much closer to the sun, but for that you need an MHD background, so a much more advanced coronal model than this Wang-Chili arch model. So this is also something we are doing. And then we also want to integrate this Paradise model into EFORIA to make them two coupled models that run simultaneously. And we want to provide it to the community in this virtual space modeling center, of which I will tell you soon. Let me just show you some of the results we obtained so far. So first, improved models, coronal models, and then I will say something about the advanced Fluxorb CME models and the integrated SEP model result. Just one result, because there's not much time. So first, we integrated an existing coronal model, which is called MultiVP. It is developed in Toulouse by the group of Alexis Rouillard and Rui Pinto. And so it was already there. It's also an MHD, but 1D MHD. They also make a potential field source surface extrapolation like we did in EFORIA. But then they solve the MHD equations along the open field lines. And so it's a much better model. It takes more time, of course, also. And we try to couple that one. So we replace the coronal part, the coronal model in EFORIA, by this MultiVP model. And then we try to find out if this combination would better predict the high-speed streams. Because when there are high, if you have a coronal hole, there's a high-speed stream coming out of that, and EFORIA typically has difficulties to predict these high-speed streams. We typically are 100 to 150 kilometers per second too slow when predicting the high-speed streams with EFORIA. And so with MultiVP, we got a much better result. Here you see in red the traditional EFORIA, so Wang-Chili arch EFORIA, and in blue the MultiVP. In black is the measurement. So you see that with the MultiVP corona, we get a much better prediction of the velocity in the high-speed stream. Density is in both cases not so good, and the temperature is slightly better with MultiVP compared to EFORIA. But we were able to, it depends also a bit on which magnetogram you have to use, because we tried different types of magnetograms, and with Wilcox magnetograms, we get the best results, actually. Here you see a visualization of isosurfaces of this velocity. In gray, you see the heliospheric current sheet. And then you see isosurfaces, and you see on the left-hand side, this is MultiVP plus EFORIA, high-speed stream that is actually hitting the Earth. The blue sphere here is the Earth. This is the Sun. And if you do not use this MultiVP model for the corona, you do not have the high-speed stream, so there is no high-speed stream available at Earth. So this is the better model, MultiVP plus EFORIA. So that was a nice intermediate result, which has been published by one of my PhD students, Evangelia Samara. Now, we also try to develop a new global MHD model, which is based on a code that we already have here, cool fluid, uses a finite volume method, an unstructured mass, because most of the models for the corona have the following problem. They have an explicit model, which means that the time step is limited by the CFL condition. I don't know if you know about numerics, but in explicit models, which are very simple, actually, there is a time step limitation, which means that if you have small grid cells, your time step is also very small. The length of the time step, the maximum length of the time step is proportional to the grid cell length. And so most of these models, they use spherical coordinates. So at the poles, you get very small grid cells, of course, because it's a singularity in their coordinates. And therefore, when they have combined it with the explicit model, you have very small time steps, and you need to do millions of time steps before you get a steady state coronal model. What we have is an unstructured grid. So we do not have the small grid cells at the poles. And moreover, we have an implicit solver. So we do not have this CFL limitation on the time step. So we can do much bigger time step. Of course, you have much more computations per time step. We have to solve a system of equations, so with an iterative procedure, but our time step can be 1,000 or 10,000 times bigger, and we only have 100 times more work per time step, so we can gain a lot of time. That was the idea. So we tried the different solvers, and we kind of applied this kind of grid, and we kind of compared to an existing model. This is called fluid. This is Wien's Predict, the model of Barbara Perry. Barbara Perry, after her PhD, she developed this model in her PhD, and after her PhD, she came to Leuven. She's actually here now working on this cool fluid model. And so we can compare the two models and see how good we are. And it turns out to be very good, actually. Here you see the CFL step in time. So we start with CFL 1, then after a while, we can go to CFL 100, so 50, I think, so 50 times larger than the maximum time step allowed in an explicit code. And then here we jump to 800. But we have cases where we can jump to a few thousand CFL steps. So much, much bigger time steps than in the explicit codes. And here you see the convergence history. So the code nicely converges. Of course, there is each time discontinuity when we change the length of the time step, but it converges very nicely to a nice corona. It turns out that for the test cases that we did with the dipole field and the quadrupole field, we only get a speed up of 4 to 5. But for a realistic solar case based on a magnetogram, we get a result in 52 minutes, while Wind Predict needs 36 hours for this particular case. So we gain a factor of 32. It's 32 times faster, and which is very important, of course, because if your coronal model takes 36 hours to converge, you cannot do too many simulations because the CME is there in 2 days. Eh? So the CME arrives when you start the simulation for the CME. So here, this is very well suited for space weather because we can forecast the corona in 1 hour instead of a day or more than a day. What we want to do is still optimize the computing time. We want to include rotation in the model and also heating cooling terms, because now we have polytropic MHD model. So kind of uniform heating, we want to make the heating dependent on the strength of magnetic field to get a more realistic model. And so we also want to improve the accuracy by R adaptation, moving grids. And also, in fact, in the end, we want to go to multi-fluid modeling. We also want to have a model for the ions and the protons in the corona. And we are also working on that. Another way to improve the heliospheric model then is to include grid stretching, because in Euphoria, we use a constrained transport method, which is very accurate. DFB is zero on machine accuracy, but we cannot stretch the grid or do adaptive mesh refining with this method. So we also did a stretch grid. So here you see a non-stretch grid where you get elongated grid cells far away from the sun, which is not good for the accuracy, the numerical accuracy. If you stretch the grid in the radial direction, yeah, here it is much smaller grid cells than there. They can keep them cubical, and which is much better for the numerical accuracy. Moreover, we can do advanced wind modeling by taking adaptive mesh refinement. Here you see a CME, and the mesh is refined as the CME is there. When the CME is gone, the mesh is coarsened again. Yeah. So you can only take the high resolution grid where it is necessary, where there is a CME, and everywhere else you can take a low resolution grid, which should also speed up the simulations, of course. We have different techniques to do this coarsening and different thresholds. You can play with it. We can also, for instance, for CIR shocks, we use a divergence of the velocity, a normalized divergence of velocity, because you can see that in the both in the reverse shock and in the leading shock here of the CIR, you get a very low value of the divergence. And so if you use that as a criterion to adapt the mesh, you can get very accurate results. We can also, of course, if there's a particular CIR, we can do the high resolution only for this particular CIR, where they will have, for instance, the CME-CIR interaction you want to model. You can play with this. This is very flexible. There's different criteria for the adaptive mesh refinement that we can apply. Of course, if you want to improve the resolution in a CME shock, you can either use the gradient of the density as a criterion for adaptive mesh refinement or the divergence of the CME velocity. And in any case, we did timings for different cases. And so the best timing, the extreme comparison that we get 28 times faster than the traditional euphoria, where we had a high resolution grid everywhere. Yeah. If you take the high resolution only where it is necessary, you can do much faster simulation. This, of course, depends on how many CMEs there are, because there are five or six CMEs, then you will have to increase the grid everywhere. But if there's only one CME, you can go up to 30 times faster. We also try to do better models. I also mentioned already mentioned the cone and the Sferamak CME. Sferamak is like here, you get the equations for the Sferamak. It's an analytical solution, but it has no legs, as I mentioned. So we also included now the Fry3D model, which is developed by Alexei Isavnin. He was also in Leuven for 2 years, and he implemented this model into Euphoria. This is a stretched flux rope with legs, so we expect much of it. It should be give much better simulations at Earth. And so we also experimented with a toroidal CME model based on a Gratia-Franoff solution, but we are validating this model. Of course, we had to find the good parameters for the Sferamak, for instance, for the velocity. We had to take into account the expansion of the CME. If you set the speed of the CME, you have to take into account the bulk speed of the CME plus the expansion speed. And we figured out how to do that, but this formula doesn't work for the Fry3D because it's not a sphere, it's a flux rope. And there, for instance, the density had to be increased, because in a Sferamak, the density is typically lower than the real density in the CME because the volume is bigger. So the total mass is the same as in the CME. But in a Fry3D, so in this flux rope model, the total volume is, of course, smaller than in a big sphere. So we had to kind of make the density a bit bigger, and we made it now 10 to the minus 17 kilograms per cubic meter, which is actually the average observed at 21.5 solar radii in this paper of Manuela Temmer, the recent paper of Manuela Temmer. So we kind of, with this higher density, higher compared to the Sferamak model, we get better results. And here you see a comparison between the two. In black are the data at L1 for the velocity, the density, the proton density, the X component, Y component, and Z component of magnetic field, the total magnetic field, and the thermal pressure. And so you see in blue is the Fry3D model, in red is the Sferamak model. You see that the Fry3D in this simulation is a bit too late. Sferamak was also too late, but Fry3D is even more late. But density is similar in both. But if you go to the magnetic field component, and especially the BZ component, you see that the BZ component is much better modeled by Fry3D. The BZ component, remember, is very important for the geo-effectiveness of the CME, to predict the geo-effectiveness of the CME. And so also the total magnetic field is of the right order of magnitude with the Fry3D model and not so with the Sferamak model. So we find that with the Fry3D, we get the prediction of the magnetic field like 37% better as compared with the Sferamak, and the BZ component is even 76% better as compared to the Sferamak. Now, to model the geo-effectiveness, we can use this synthetic data at L1 and combine it with prediction models for the DST index. DST index is an index that kind of measures the global perturbation of the magnetosphere magnetic field, which gives you an idea of geomagnetic storms. If it gets negative, this DST index, you get a geomagnetic storm, and the more negative, the stronger the storm will be. And you see here in red again the Svenmark, in blue the Frey 3D prediction of the velocity and of the BZ component. And here is the density prediction. And then if you compare that with the DST that we get, so we use these data for the DST model. It's a simple empirical model from O'Brien and McFerrin, published in 2000 already. It's a formula. Well, it's actually a differential equation that you have to solve. But okay, it gives a good prediction if you use real data. Here in the broken line here is a prediction of this model with the real data. And you see that with the Svenmark model, the red line, we cannot predict the negative DST, for this particular case at least. But with the blue line, so the with Frey 3D model, we can predict it, although it is too late, but because of course the BZ component becomes negative, but too late in the model, because the CME arrives too late. Also the DST gets the right value, but too late. So we have to improve this a bit. You have to play, I think, to get also the right formula to predict the, or to set the initial velocity of the Frey 3D CME to get a better time of arrival, and then we can predict also the geo-effectiveness of the model. One last thing I want to show is the result of Paradise, because we recently analyzed PSP data, so the Parker Solar Probe, which is going close to the sun. At this point, it was not so good, it was halfway, I think, at the sun, and you have measurements of the wind at the Parker Solar Probe and at 0A. We try to model this with Euphoria first, so to get the background magnetic field correct. Here you see the modeling. In red is the modeling of the velocity, the density, and the magnetic field. And then we put the seed particles, and we compute the particle transport and acceleration. And this is what we got at 0A. So here on left is a measurement. On the right is the simulation. And you see we are in the same order of magnitude. You see that we have the main features. These are for different energy levels. You see here this double peak. We also see it in the simulation, both for this green and red energy levels. You don't have the peak, double peak in the lower energy levels, also not in the simulation. But it looks very similar, don't you agree? So in that sense, we not only qualitatively, but also quantitatively can predict the energy particle accelerations measured at several points, in situ points in the grid. Now we want to combine these two in the modeling center. I have one more slide on the virtual space modeling center, which is also developed in Leuven by my team, actually, and other teams as well, of course. But the idea is there to gather different space weather models and put them together in the same environment and then couple them to each other. And so the user can then run these models interactively. There's a similar thing set up in America, in NASA, in Goddard Space Flight Center called CCMC. And there you can do runs on demand. They have many more models actually, but you can not run them yourself. You can say, okay, I want to run this model with this data. They do the model run for you and they send you the data. In our case, you can log in and you can just run the models yourself and make couplings yourself even. So it's a bit different, but the idea is the following. So we have a server, a virtual server actually, on which we installed this modeling center. And the models, they stay with the modelers. Some of the models, of course, our own models are running in Leuven, so inside the firewall of KLeuven. But other models that we included are sitting in Paris, in London, Imperial College, in Lancashire, models in Brussels also, models in Toulouse. And so we run them, we can steer them from here, from Leuven. We can just trigger them, and then they run on their computer locally, and they send the results. So we couple the models over the internet, basically. And we can also use databases externally. So we made holes in the firewall to be able to do this. And so what we did so far is, this was the first operational version, which was in May 2019. We had Euphoria included. We have GUMIX, is a magnetosphere model. Bas radiation belt model, KP, next DST, next models, and so. And we could couple all these arrows indicate the model couplings. And so actually you can in principle try it yourself. So there's on the web pages of the Heliospheric Weather Expert Service Center, there's a product demonstration button you can see here, and then you can click on the Virtual Space and Modeling Center. Of course, you need first credentials, but you just have to ask them and they give you the credentials, then you can log in and you can use all these models. There is no time for a demo, unfortunately, but maybe in a different occasion I can do that. One more thing we want to do is put the FluxRoad model inside the MHD Corona that we developed already. And we know how to do it, we know what we want to do, we hire the persons, and this is being done now. And then once we have installed that, we can actually start the gradual SAP events from the low corona, and this is will be a much better model, I think. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor, for your wonderful talk. Do you have some questions?
Oh, yes. So first we ask other questions, people. Okay.
So we have few questions in the chat from our participants. I'll just read out these questions to you. And okay. You may answer them.
Which one do you want to start?
I'm just scrolling the chat. Let me.
Yes.
There is a question from Mr. Noor Bhatt. May please elaborate the multidisciplinary of space weather?
Ah, yes. Okay. So this is, I mentioned it is multidisciplinary, of course, because the phenomena that we see require numerical simulation models. So there's, of course, the mathematics involved, there's physics involved, there is informatics involved, computer science. To speed up, because we need to do the simulation in a very short time interval to be able to do ensemble simulations. So these are already three fields, research fields, but there's also chemistry actually. So for instance, in this ionosphere, what is going on is chemical reactions. And if you want to model that, you also, I'm not an expert in that either, but there are models that take that into account. And also in the low atmosphere of the sun, I mentioned this multi fluid models, but there also you have ionization and recombination effects that you can take into account, and also the radiation has to be taken into account. So there's many different fields that are, you need expertise from different fields. So I think there's not a single group in the world that can do this alone. So to model the space weather, you need a consortia of teams, like in the prediction of Earth weather. Yeah, at some point in time, all these little models were put together in a global effort, and then they developed this global circulation model by just bringing all the models and the expertise together. It's very similar in space weather. So it's complicated, and therefore you need many different expertises, many different research fields.
Then we have a question from Mr. Azhar Abbas, and he is not still clear about the effect of electromagnetic radiation resulting from human activities on the aeroplane and aircraft motion.
Well, so there is indeed a radiation measured in spacecraft also, in airplanes also, by the way. So in airplanes, it is of course less, because the lower you fly, the more you get protection from the atmosphere. But you know that airplanes fly always higher because there's less resistance of, and you can go faster. And they also, for transatlantic flights, they go over the radiation belt. So they go as more northern latitudes. And so there, the spatial effects are the largest effect. So when they do this during a geomagnetic storm, the crew and the passengers, they get a radiation dose because of these particles. And the radiation dose is of the order of X-ray photography of your chest. Okay, this is okay if it is only once per year, but if you fly frequently, and particularly the crew, for instance, They fly there every week, so they get a lot of radiation, and so there are actually medical studies ongoing now to measure the impact of that on the crew. And they're especially worried about the pregnant stewardesses, of course, because there are already some claims, I think, about miscarriages that might have been induced by this radiation. Now, of course, if you go to the astronauts in the International Space Station, they are even less protected because they are 600 kilometers above the ground. And so there, when they stay inside, it is no problem. But I talked to people that were involved in this, and they actually mentioned to me that the International Space Station, when it was developed, they didn't know yet about these effects. And so the sleeping area of these astronauts is not very well protected. So if there's a space storm going on, they are advised to go and sleep in the computer room, because there's, of course, a cage of Faraday, of course, around the computers to protect the computers. And so they are much better protected there. This is what this person told me. So there also, indeed, you get radiation during these events.
Thank you. Then we have a question from Ms. Muniba Yasin. If the gravity of Earth is varied, then the solar effect will be varied. If yes, then how it will affect the Earth weather?
If what is affected, varied, the gravity?
If the gravity of Earth is varied, then the solar effect will be varied. If yes, then how will it affect the Earth's weather?
But how are you going to vary the gravity at Earth? I do not understand the question.
Okay, then I will just forward this on your email, and then you can respond. I can share it with her on the email again.
Yeah, I'm trying to. At what time was this? Was the comment given? Can you tell me?
It was on 14 past four.
14 past four. That is, yeah, here. If the gravity of Earth is varied, then the effect will be varied. I'm not sure how you're going to vary the gravity of Earth. But of course, what is important is the magnetic shield. Yeah. So if you if the magnetic shield of the Earth is varied, then our protection is changing. And there are actually people that are worried about that, because you know that the magnetic field of the Earth is also reversing every so many years. Right? It's now 800,000 years ago, I think, but it's also normally every 100,000 or 200,000 years, it should also reverse. And during the reversal, it is very weak. So the magnetic protection will be smaller. And there are some people that claim that it is actually ongoing now, because it doesn't reverse in one day. Eh? It takes like 100 years. And some people say there are, in fact, in the northern hemisphere, regions where the magnetic field is weaker, and even with an inverse polarity in the northern hemisphere, and the same in the southern hemisphere. And to some people, this means that the magnetic field of the Earth is actually in the process of being reversed, and that, I don't know what that might be, might have a big effect, because it means that the impact of space weather will be much larger, and the impact of the radiation will be much larger than now, actually. But I don't know if that is true, that it is actually reversing now, but that could be a potential very risky business indeed.
So, Stephen, may I ask a few questions from you? So, sure. One is that we know that in different regions of our sun, for example, on the surface, it is a collisional plasma, and then in chromosphere and corona, maybe generally collisionless plasma, etc. And very high temperature plasma in corona. So, when the temperatures are high, and the plasma is collisionless, generally fluid model is thought not to be very good. But on the other hand, for global studies, we have to use MHDR fluid models. So what is the technical or mathematical justification that why in physics MHD is very good for corona, chromosphere, etc., but mathematically we know it may not be?
I agree fully. Of course, the best thing would be to use kinetic models for this. But kinetic models are still very challenging for computers, even for nowadays supercomputers. You cannot do such a global simulation with a kinetic model. It would take way too long. And I remember there's a time limit, so you need to do a simulation in a couple of hours, otherwise you are behind the real event. So it's improving, of course, because now I saw that there are some people are developing models for the kinetic models for the magnetosphere, the global magnetosphere of the Earth. Yeah. So that means that they if you have a huge computer available, then you can do these kind of simulations. And one day we will be able actually to do a kinetic simulation of the whole Sun-Earth system. But for the time being, this is not possible, and certainly not in just a couple of hours. So we still use MHD as long as we have to. And surprisingly, it gives rather good results, I must say. Yeah. Of course, in some sense, the conditions to justify the MHD model are not always satisfied, although it depends on how you look at it. So the main problem is in the mean free path, according to some people, because the mean free path is huge in the corona and in the wind. But I don't think that is actually a condition. The conditions when you derive the MHD equations are, for instance, that you have typical lengths that are larger than the Bay length and ion and electron gyro radius and such that, and the length scales that we are working on now are indeed much larger than that. So in that sense, for a global modeling, it is still okay, and this is shown by the very good.
So one question. Because I am working on generation of spatials at present. So what is your opinion? Because in ICTP, I heard from some speakers that they were saying that maybe the coronal lobes, they originate from the regions below the surface, etc. But I think that the spicules and spicules may be generated in the chromosphere due to density and temperature non-uniformities. And what I have found is that due to temperature gradient and density gradient, plasma gets accelerated in the vertical direction, means perpendicular to the surface of the Earth. So this can be a possible mechanism for the generation of spicules. And when at higher temperatures, the temperature becomes uniform almost, and gradient vanishes in perpendicular direction, the acceleration becomes zero and velocity becomes zero, and so it has finite height.
I think indeed in this lower region of the corona, the models that we have now are not very good. We shouldn't take into account multi-fluid effects, and you get these speakers in a natural way in that sense. We have a model. I work together with a group in Poland, in Lublin, and there they do some simulations with a multi-fluid code, Joanna it is called. And we're actually working on speakers as well, I think. And they get them also in a kind of natural way. So they get this acceleration of the plasma just from doing a two-fluid simulation of the chromosphere. So maybe you should talk about that, because it would be good to test.
And similarly, coronal lobes, they can be originated from the corona and upper chromosphere. Do you think?
I think that would be possible. Yeah, of course, the general idea is that it comes from the dynamo theory. Yeah, so you know that they think that these loops are created by these flux tubes that are in the lower part of the convection zone, very strong flux tube, and then they boil up, and then they get through the photosphere and they make these loops. But I don't think it is already conclusive there. So there might be other ways to create coronal loops indeed. Sure.
So Stephen, I am very grateful to you for a very wonderful lecture. And particularly it is very informative for me. And maybe I will have some discussion with you through emails. And I hope it will be very inspiring for the people who are listening your talk, and it can give them insight into the solar dynamics, etc. So great. Thank you very much from ComSats.
You're welcome.
So if Dr. Iqbal is there, if he can, he want to say anything. He's not here, I think.
No, he was in another meeting. Okay. And on behalf of Comstech, we also thank you a lot for taking out time and giving lecture to our participants from different countries and time zones. So we look forward to see you again in future as well in another lecture.
Okay.
And we hope so that this pandemic is over and you can travel to Pakistan or any other country to give lectures on this topic.
I think we are all hoping for that. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Bye.